want you to hear me. It's amazing how much of a kindergarten tricks work. Hello everybody, welcome to this now heated discussion about the far right and how to defeat it within the city of Boston and the surrounding area. My name is Peter. I use he, his pronouns. I'm an organizer with the Boston chapter of the Democratic Socialist of America. I've been involved with anti-fascist organizing for, a couple of years now. So how this meeting is going to be structured is we're going to have a panel, which I'm facilitating. There are five people on it. One of them is finding parking, but will be here. I will introduce them to you in turn. We will then have a question and answer session. And we're trying to get out of here at 9, so we're going to try and have a hard stop. And if you have further questions, you can always direct them by email or Facebook to our group. Before we get to our panel, there's a few sort of announcements and ground rules. First, and this is pretty important, we have to ask that you respect people's privacy concerns and not take photographs or video. We haven't noticed they were doing it yet, so that's already ahead. Second, and this should go without saying, but like I said, fascists and bigots are not welcome here. If you are one, don't be here. The whole range. Our security team will escort people out who are disruptive or break those rules. So please help. I don't think anybody will. So that's good. The format here is each speaker is going to have 10 minutes, and I'll wait at you if you have a deadline. And now that that's out of the way, if I may, I'd like to introduce our first speaker. Chip Gerlay has spent over 40 years studying and writing about right-wing movements, most of it at Political Research Associates in Somerville. He is a co-author along with Matthew Ryan, the classic book, Right-Wing Populism Too Close for Comfort. His new book is called Trumping Democracy in the United States, A Raven to the Right, which is an edited collection throughout next month for Routledge.
Other years I worked for a Lincoln financial professor who gave me a stopwatch instead of my co-workers. Please stand down, it's social. So, I don't think everything to be about the output. I was, in fact, an editor of the National Association. I was not, in fact, an honest member of the National Association. I was thinking to do research. There's a crisis. We all know it. So, I should talk a little bit about the need for a broadest coalition possible because of the threat to so many different types of people and groups. We have multiple opponents. 1% power leaders, business nationalists, business internationalists, city of finance, both Republican and Democratic parties. We have ideologies that we have to fight like white supremacy, white nationalism, misogyny. Xenophobia is a mess. And then the utopia is built down into Mexicans, Americans, Islam, anti-Semitism. Obviously, people of color are still seen in the xenophobia, but it is a lot of the because they're not the real people. The real people, when you've got a white populist movement, are the people who are acceptable to the making of the country. Now, what that means is those people are either pushed out or messed up and beaten up in the streets, or there's a genocide. So it never ends well. It gets towards the middle. I think it's really important to fight for concrete democracy and human rights for everyone, no exceptions. That includes democracy and human rights for people they control, the people who are being wrong tenants. So that, it's got to be everybody against democracy. Now, it doesn't mean if somebody being misogynist or homophobic or racist that you can't call them out. And you are welcome to do that for a language in their face. But you shouldn't round them up and put them in places like those children right now. And so that's the difference, is that there are things that are not acceptable. So nobody gets thrown under the bus or out of the lifeboat. I need to go out and go into the life of and it's a morality play. So like with the, you know, you get a copies of the play, he pops out. But it's a morality play trying out. These people in the white world, who gets thrown out? Does anybody get thrown out? Why do people make different decisions about what they decide to do with an injured person and then a surprise guest of a white world that is revealed much further? So that's an discussion that you have with people in your neighborhood. You can cycle over to watch the you can bring it to any place where you have a fraternal type of organization or whatever. So, whatever. Fraternal, that's all right, go back 4 years. So that you have basically different organizations that you go to that are actually not concerned about fascism, but should be, and show the light bulbs. Who wants to throw everybody except the real people for that one? That are fascists, by the way. The thing you need to know about fascism is that Griffin and Kasdan and a bunch of other scholars are saying superior psychosis and right psychology. They have come to the decision over 20 years that right-wing populist rhetoric is a form of scapegoat. It's essentially bound inside fascism. So fascism is the most militant and murderous form of right-wing populism. What we have in America now, and right-wing populism. So you and I and everyone else who can mobilize has to act against the actual appearance of fascism, which is not a lot of us before it's too late. They go together, fascism is a strategic together, it's a fascism. And the joke is, by the time most people realize it might be fascism, it's too late. So we have to be both defensive and the offense. We have to be brought up to talk to our neighbors. Whenever I go to a city to hear a speech, I sit down at a bus stop and I make myself have conversations with people who don't want to talk to me about what's going on. But I don't let it and I say, I don't know, it's, you know, barbed wire cage, you know, that pops because it bothers you. And then I shut up and they talk for a while. And then you can have a conversation. Don't give them a chance to talk for a while. It's not a real conversation. And what you'll find is a lot of people say, well, you know, and it bothers me too, but I don't know what you're supposed to do when you have a conversation. They'll sit there and say, it's not a mistake, and it's not a smart person. Who wants that in your life? Well, not the ethical. I don't know, it depends on what the ethical response is. I think it does in fact make sense to go to the least obnoxious person who has a chance of beating a Republican. I know all the arguments, you know, for the public the other thing is to maintain international solidarity with all things like the repression and genocide. And to me that includes opposition to tyrants of the right hand and the left. Typically cyber example quotes from Putin, Sato Apocalypse. Because he's like populist, he's like treating his own people like dirt. So that sadistic populist thinks they're populist. I've heard that term before. It actually works for people. Eco-socialism. If we can't maintain a political system in an earth that's dying, so somewhere we have to keep in mind that we need to protect the earth and build awareness of ecology across all boundaries. Because otherwise, you know, it's the roaches, the anyhow, denying all race, gender, and class is a failed analysis. I'm going to repeat that. Any analysis that does not incorporate race, gender, and class is incomplete and not acceptable. Because that is how we figure out how to build a future that eradicates of oppression that this country was built on from the very first settlers who were Christian men and thought killing Indians was ordained by God and thought that Boston was the new Jerusalem and they were going to purify and make the Christian nation so that Jesus would come back. I haven't seen him lately and I'm a Christian. I don't expect him coming back to the very soon because I'm not a Christian. That may happen. Next. But there are millions of people who are Christians who think that. we are able to say. Now, people think what I say is that I'm exaggerating, but if you read their actual books and films, watch their films, and watch what they see in each other, they are the communities that they are not the agents of. You can apply.
Oh, I thought you were collecting them. I thought you were collecting them.
There are bad people. They're out to get us. Many of them are secret. We have to stop them, and we have to start with people we know of it. Like Democrats, some people wish that was. And finally, there is a special script. No meeting debate, and I don't think we should turn this into a debate of the fine points of scholarly points. We can debate whether it's soon be fascist, it's fascist now, it's never be fascist, while it's fighting to defend democracy and human rights in America. And so I'm on a panel here with people who probably make me the most conservative person in the room, and I'm happy to be on this panel because we need the broadest possible coalition to stop fascism from becoming a reality.
Talking about outliers and what is important, what are the things that come together to make years ago, but one thing that came to mind is how we treat people who have skills in math. You talked about it. And then when there's this way of teaching that people who excel at it, go to the top, and those are the experts. Those are the folks who we have a natural ability. But when it comes to a subject like math, math takes hard work, it takes perseverance, it takes effort to become good at it. And some of us will be able to be good at whatever point, and other people may take some time, but we all can be good at math. So when we think about white supremacy, how to tackle white supremacy, they're not just people in society who are the actors, who just know. They're people who have done the work, they've studied, they've read the articles, they've talked to people who are doing all types of community connecting. A lot of them are doing solidarity economy networks, they know about trade unions, they know about other ways of sharing, talking about building an entirely different society in which things like this cannot exist. So fascism, we talk about it on the local scene, you can't just go to things that are prescribed to you to deal with fascism, because the way that we live in this country has already been set up to benefit a certain people. So there's master's not gonna, can't tear down master's house with a master's school. It doesn't make sense, it doesn't work like that. And so having a multi-ethnic, multi-racial, multi-religious coalition, but of all different compositions of people coming together and doing the things we need to figure out how to do this is how we can pass it. So when they show up, there's a wider range of things that we can do to respond to them. Some of them have been sanctioned and some of them will be celebrated and seen as good. Other things are a little bit more tactical. Other things are a little less savory. But it's what you allow and the things that come through that are going to define you as a people. So when crashes come around, I'm not having a conversation about, am I presenting this in the most non-violent, struggle that Gene Sharp has told me about. I'm reading about some narratives. I'm being true to these models and models. I'm thinking about, am I going to be purposeful in the way that I protect my community? It's going to be safe. Is it sustainable? Can somebody pick this up after I put it down? And I'll be going to win. I'm going to get free. And I think we can do that. But we have to shift out of this. Let me see who's going to be the next Democratic candidate to come up for the 2020 elections. We've got to think more locally, we've got to think more in terms of neighborhoods and things, in terms of council things, in terms of groups of friends, and coming together and how we can make a change. That's what we do that when we talk about this next year and next year. Yeah.
Thank you.
Was his politics as politics as healthcare.
part of life, these people is part of life, knowing that there's so much to walk away from you. Give a hug, tell them love them, but they're not going to come back when there's just a problem in your brothers or in other city entry, they get health insurance. And that just becomes pointless. It's really like setting up a fascism. No, you can just put it and say no more. I'm not doing this anymore. I'm not sitting and watching my parents dying. And it's very personal, it's very real. Because they say just ignore them. Just ignore them. Well, they go home and they need to live their lives. Just ignore them. They go home and change action. Just ignore them. But we can't confront them on the street. Where else can we confront them? We can't confront them when they organize. How can we confront them in our homes? How can we tell other people to confront them? And it's just kind of like personal attachment. Politically, it's just like that very march. No, thank you. No, thank you for doing that. I'm not saying, well, thank you. But we need a deep, broad, responsible coalition. We need to override the tactics to stop. Because every time you get to the street, that's an organized opportunity. But to get to know each other and to learn how each other work and to learn how they work together. It's like a sport. I play a lot of sports and that's a job. It's a little shameful, but also I love that shame. In the season, it's all getting good. You play a few games, all of a sudden things start working well. So people say just ignore them on the street, and so we love them to train. We give them time to know each other, it has exchange contact information. We give them time to exchange information about us. No, not that. You can't do that. So just have a lot of faith to have a whole. We don't want a strong fascist. We can't allow them space to live. And by giving them a platform and not compressing them, we're not going to fit. And that's why they also identify this past year not only has the best health workers in the streets, they also have this app for this to pressure local businesses not providing space to organize. Because as luck is, we have this improvement history of organizing things a lot. Well, I mean, we share a cell together, a farm together, we're insurance history, people are organizing equipment. That shared space is what allows us to grow. So also having that second aspect of making sure they don't have a secondary insurance space to share their problems, like that work for in their case. And their service organizing. And then if we're going to take action organizing, we better prepare ourselves for the bigger fights. Because, you know, resistant racism, injury fraud, all these groups, they're the truth. We're really up in some ways when there's people who do something and try to make it happen. But then we have the it's the thought that we that there's a very huge system of white supremacy. That type of place are operating in a male supremacy, but you know, we're saying we have numbers that these words are just as many people as they are people of color. They help us, they serve to protect the defend for us. And they, we have to realize that. Because that's something like a lot of feminism has failed to do. But if we had left this, we had to build a broad coalition to worry that there are certain things that are unacceptable. Certain things are uncomfortable. The sports that we cannot allow our street. But we can connect around that and allow our resistance tactics while still having respect and having to be fast about certain schools or problems or media. So that creates a foundation in which we can build for these large, more complicated fights when we do have real ideological differences. That pushes over left is hard. We have different figures, we can have that base on them. Like, this is where we draw the line. That makes us stronger. If I can trust, like, I will say that, you know, a couple years ago, I've never been a lot of women side by side people with other like, socialists. I didn't know that. I was very, very sectarian. You believe what you believe, you want to fight for it, and you're so caught up in these like, internal fights The bigger picture is that we have like white supremacist conflicts and a racist group. It doesn't want that. And he's the most powerful man in the United States. And he has emboldened what most of us have to see growing for the past 10 years. We don't have time left to buy a lot of ourselves. We know we haven't had time, especially from that time left. And I believe we can win. I believe we can win. I believe that white supremacy can end, presence can end, and race. We can think that we can't be conceptual. I think that future is possible. I don't believe it's that far away. I do think we're never going to get to go fight for it, go ask for the companion. And part of what we're going to constrain the market is to make that future now. And the future doesn't have what we know. Thank you.
Also at United, right?
Boston, despite living 3,000 miles away. So there was always that connection. Boston free speech always had a very heavy presence of anti-communist action. I first noticed that in May 2017, Boston free speech fascist rally, because they were out in their gear, which at that point they had their support, and then their logo was everywhere, which makes confusion. And then I also saw one on the end that that August, like the anti-com people, support blogs that were really going to harm by it. See that for that August 2017 rally, that they were talking to crew on the anti-com Discord server to get people to turn on. And so that connection, and anti-com also did security for Richard Spencer's speech in Gainesville, Florida. So, like, that connection was always there, and now with the Unite the Right 2, Jody Ball was a Proud Boy in New York City, in Brooklyn. He co-sponsored the Marxism Security Rally in New York City a while back, and he's worked with them before, and he had lost free speech. The Proud Boys rally in April, tried to get over really how the protesters were together. But he was a speaker at the Right 2 this past weekend. And in fact, the Discourses in the New York City rally had multiple people who worked in the regular planning, the Right 2 planning office. Attending their rally, as well as the speaker who would go there. So it's always been disingenuous for them to play at the because they disavow the card so he doesn't hear. Anyway, I came back from that, and then a few days later, the Holocaust Memorial was vandalized. And I went to the Joel, it's like a Jewish, and I work with a Jewish group that. Organized individual for that, and then a few days later was the Boston rally, and I was a little nervous after Unite the Right, but it turned out to be great, and so many counter-protesters showed up. Of course, then there was a lot of police violence against some of them. I remember that, and I treated some of it. But it was very effective at stopping the momentum here. And forcing them to rebuild, and the numbers showed what we could do. And then, the thing was that they did start to rebuild. They've been running actions ever since then. They don't have the numbers that they used to, but they want to. That's what the whole organizing work that Sarah was talking about is that they're trying to meet each other. They're trying to trust actions. And we've seen recently, some of you may have followed the various cities, Portland, Oregon, both the Patriot Fair rally there and with the Proud Boys involvement. And the violence against fascists, so the majority of street fascists, and then more recently, the violence against them from the police, because these things are always intertwined. Like I've seen over and over that police will give bells and whistles to street fascists that they don't get to left groups, and they'll take their side. Like I've had police take the side of street fascists who were literally like threatening to rape me and let anybody like on the spot. So that's like they're not helpful. So if you've seen the news in Portland, the Patriot Prayer was one of the original like constituent organizations of the Discourses. That's on the website.
And like, what exists in Portland is, in my opinion, what the street fascists always want to see here. And I think that had the numbers not come out early in last August, I think they would be much, much closer to that here now. Like, that's what they want to be. And people don't always understand that, because this is something of the far right that presents and that tries to present as being not over, they're not walking around in really Nazi suits and such. But like, sometimes they do, but like, they're trying to be more like public friendly, but then they have all their cliche helicopter meetings. Like, they don't honestly do a very good job of pretending to be moderates, but like, they do a lot of American stories what different factors look like, so they don't necessarily see that. And they don't, they get confused when they see the Proud Boys who are not white, and there's also the Proud Boys who are not white. And they don't see how, like, there's a lot of different axes of oppression that go into these ideologies. Like, they have messy coalitions, just like the left does, like misogyny, Islamophobia, anti-Semitism, queerphobia, and transphobia. Like, that those are all to like different parts of their coalition. And so I think that, like, a lot of people have said that, oh, the alt-right died after the first United Right. One way to look at that United Right too was, it only was because they, because of hundreds of hours of organizing against it, didn't happen that magic. But the thing is, as that over part has like run into its problems, I think the current bill might be having trouble recognizing has been settled. And so I think that is something that we have to organize against, and we also have to be able to analyze this talk, because it is ultimately connected to both those larger structures of oppression, police and prison deportations, and also to the really overt, like, stereotypical Nazi, throwing Nazi salutes and wearing swastikas in the way of, in some ways, it's a bridge.
Strong enough
you would never hear anything again about free speech.
The first thing
that they're going to do, they're against free speech. They use it cynically, they're operators, and they're completely dishonest and they're liars. One thing that struck me when Kitty was speaking about how they disavow, they quote disavow things. Jason Kessler, who organized both the United Rights Allies, he's talking about how he's not a Nazi, we're just white, you know, we're advocates for white people, we're not in favor of violence. Last year, the immediate aftermath of Heather Heyer being killed, he celebrated her death. Literally celebrated her death on Twitter and said this is payback time for all the victims of Tommy. He said it was some insane fever dream tweet that he put together, but this is somebody who celebrated her murder. And this is, I think this is what Albright is. They want to be able to mobilize hundreds of people in the streets. They want to be able to carry out violence against left-wing rallies. They want to attack press people. They want to attack the left. They have a big picture goal of smashing up trade unions. I mean, this is what they represent. And just because they're small doesn't mean that they shouldn't be taken very seriously. You know, if 5 of them show up to a demonstration here that the left calls, I think we should link arms and push them out every single time. Because what Sarah said is so important. They use these types of street confrontations. They don't show up and think, oh, I hope we don't get into the confrontation. They show up to confront us so they can bring in new recruits in sort of a crucible of violence. That is how they recruit, and that's how they build, and that's how they strengthen their organization. So just because they're small, they're down, and they're not up. I wanted to just say that. We should take very seriously anytime they attempt to hold, anytime they try to organize their own rally, which is what they're doing on the 18th, or anytime they've shown up to a number of sort of progressive demonstrations in Boston last year, from things as big as the second anniversary of the Women's March to May Day. I mean, they've just been showing up to things. And we have to take that very seriously and understand what they represent as a political phenomenon. So, sorry, I talked about this thing about this. I just want to say it is worth thinking about where we were a year ago, maybe more than a year ago, like last spring into the summer, like where we were in terms of their growth and what they represented. You know, Trump had just won, obviously. He was celebrated by people like, you know, Albright, Union Kirk, a sort of Trojan horse for the mainstream. Richard Spencer went viral, they were a media sensation, and crucially, in the spring and up into the summer, and sort of the climax of this was in Charlottesville, they were able to mobilize hundreds of far-right extreme fighters in city after city around the country. They did it everywhere. They had a real sense of momentum. They had a real sense of purpose. And I don't know if people remember, but like last spring and birthday, they went on a rampage. Like they attacked people, they beat people, and honestly, they did that very recently in Portland, Texas. So just again, down the hot up, and look, it's only in terms of where you're talking about regional. Because there's still, I mean, you look at a place like Portland, they're able to mobilize hundreds of people in, again, full combat here to fight the left. This is how they build, this is how they recruit, this is how they strengthen their forces. And this is something really important about resist Marxism connection to Patriot prayer in Portland. The leader, one of the underground leaders of resist Marxism here in Boston, Mark Sahady, shows up here in Boston with a small group of people. He's in, you know, plain clothes. He's talking about free speech. There's a picture of him from 2 weeks ago in Portland, dressed like he's at the Unite the Right rally last year, full combat gear. So these, again, they're cynical, they're liars. You can't take them into face value in terms of what they're saying. They're building, they're trying to build national connections, when you build some strength, right? So time. They're trying to build.
Yeah, you have more fun.
Oh, great, awesome. Yes. there's networks locally, nationally, internationally. They think of themselves as a very serious, and I think we should do this, a very serious political movement that wants to contend for political power. Right now, it's one thing, in years of time, I mean, something different. But, so it was a year ago. We were sort of, people were kind of focused on them, but it wasn't like a big decisive blow against them. And then, obviously what happened in Charlottesville a year ago happened. And, that was horrifying and torturous. I was watching the footage of that, and it was like a nightmare. I was watching it recently, just a couple days ago, like this, it was not that long ago. And the fellow trail park in the White House is still there. I mean, what did he say on Facebook? Last year, famously said, he blamed me on the left, there's bad people on both sides. This year, he said he can have all violence. No specific condemnation of white supremacists.
Can I get some correction?
Sure.
He didn't say that for both sides. He said they're blind people.
Finally, yeah,
right. Yeah, exactly.
I mean, okay, they can only turn out 20 people now. So what? The president literally is a fellow traveler of a movement that offers them political cover. It's the president who calls immigrants animals. But the ease with which the president goes around disgusting and racist language in the political mainstream to tell us all we need to know about the very fertile terrain the far right is potentially operating on. Down but not up. We have to really maintain this focus on them as a political force. And Boston happened last year, and it broke that momentum. The estimates ran from 20,000 to 40,000. There's tens of thousands of people who showed up immediately after what happened in Charlottesville. And it had a very demoralizing effect here in Boston. They were run off the common, which was amazing. And in the weeks immediately following it, they canceled. There were like all these Islamophobic rallies scheduled around the country, and they all got canceled. Because there was a sense of, oh my God, look, this just happened in Boston. This wave of people just ran us out. I think we were recruited. We're under intense pressure after the president. We're under this intense pressure. So they really did. They were dealt with three sustained defeat by the artists. In the fall, they tried to force like the traditional workers' party, said, okay, maybe we should retreat from the large local cities and go into places. Smaller towns in Tennessee, maybe we should target Appalachia. Look, they lost there too. They were badly unmobilized. I forget the exact towns in Tennessee, they were badly unmobilized there. There was a downward trend. But again, what when we've seen them regaining some of their strength? When abolish ICE emerged as a second hashtag against the child detention centers, there were like Occupy style encampments set up around ICE offices around the country. And Patriot Front, which was the organization, they changed their name. They were the organization that James Field was in. He ran his farm through that crowd in Charlottesville. They've been attacking these encampments. But I think we have to understand that it's been hard for them to regroup, and it's been uneven, but they have been regrouped. They feel more confident to attack these types of demonstrations. And here in Boston, they're pushing for an all-out mobilization on the 18th. So, I'm pretty much at the end.
Yeah.
Okay, I just want to, say that they really only understand one thing, which is political confrontation against them, which is, I think spaces like this in the city are so important, and we have a real responsibility anytime they turn out, which is to counter-protest them, and really try to smash up their confidence, demoralize them to the extent that we can, each and every time. What Kitty said, they want what happened in Portland a couple weeks ago in America. They want to go from 20 people here in Boston to that. Would we rather deal with them when there are 300 of them and they're walking around in combat gear? Or would we rather crush them? Would we rather crush them with only a few dozen of them? I'll take the latter option. So I just wanted to say, I'll just wrap up. I think everyone here, please come Saturday and bring something.